For having us, it's great to be in this beautiful space. In fact, we're having our State of the City speech, you're all invited to, on October 3rd upstairs to celebrate the great rebirth of this incredible facility. I believe the city is moving in the right direction. In fact, I think it's moving in a better direction than it has for most of my life. I'm 43 years old. Over the last couple of years, we've seen an enormous explosion of new jobs, whether it's GE on the banks, Mercy Hospital putting its headquarters in Bond Hill, Kroger building the first grocery store downtown in 40 years with a $90 million project on top, and of course, the largest single investment in the history of the city, the expansion of Children's Hospital. These are exciting projects. Forbes magazine has said 2 years in a row that the city is the number one city in America for someone with a college degree. And I believe that it's because of our proven track record of progress that we're seeing those great gains. And I don't believe we can afford to put that progress at risk. How do we get here? I believe we put together the foundations of the building blocks for growth. We balanced the budget after years of it being unbalanced. We solved a problem that had been kicked down the road, the pension crisis. We ended brownouts, which is not enough firefighters, at the very time that the heroin crisis was exploding, when we needed them to respond to ODs. We put more cops on the street, and we have made sure that we've invested in roads and bridges and infrastructure again. But on top of that, we've made sure that our progress is progressive. And so under our leadership, together, working together, we passed a living wage of $15 an hour for all city workers and contract workers. We have worked in probably the largest grassroots effort, united with the human service organizations, the hospitals, the business community, to launch the Child Poverty Declarer to help 5,000 families transition out of poverty over the next 5 years. In fact, today we had a major press conference with the folks who are already engaged in the work. And this is new private dollars focused on fighting poverty. In addition, next week we'll be launching the largest city investment in the country in solar renewable energy. I'm proposing that we put solar panels up throughout Lunkin Airport, as they did at the Denver Airport, and use other city facilities, including the old landfill on Center Hill, as a location for solar panels. And what I'm proposing is that that energy used to power our waterworks system. I like the idea of the sun powering our water consumption needs as a city. On a going forward basis, we will also continue to work together to solve the public health emergency of the heroin epidemic. Our first responders, and we launched a lawsuit to hold accountable the drug companies and distributors who have caused a lot of these problems. But big picture, I see I'm out of time, is that everything depends on job growth, and I don't think we can afford to put our successful policies at risk. Thank you. I'd like to answer that question, although I have to respond to some of the personal statements that my Councilmember Simpson just made. Let me be clear. I support saving King Records because James Brown recorded all of his famous songs there, because it's one of the hallmarks of the good things that we did during the Civil Rights Movement. And I make no apologies for that. It's true that Bootsy Collins has become a friend. It's true that Philip Paul, an artist, has become a close friend. So has Otis Williams, all of whom are extremely famous musicians who came from Cincinnati and came from Evanston and came and performed their great music here. This is great living space. I was moved when I went years ago to see the Sun Records in Memphis, as well as Stax in Memphis. And this is a good thing. And I don't know why anyone's trying to make that personal. It's my understanding that Councilmember Simpson supported saving King Records also. And I think it should also be pointed out that the appointments to the Historic Conservation Board are made by the city manager, not by the mayor. So I'm not sure what all those other personal allegations were about. But I do know that the city administration and the preservation group recommended against the demolition of the Denison, and it was only on appeal that the Denison was allowed to be torn down. So I think if we're going to have an honest debate, let's keep it honest. I believe that the adaptive reuse of these amazing historic districts and communities is a key to the great renaissance that we're seeing. I'm proud that I led as a city council person with former council member Crowley and Lakita Cole and many others, the TIF districts that were put in place to help pay for the sparks of the revitalization of Over the Rhine, including the funding for Washington Park and Ziegler Park. In addition, in the private sector, I led the effort to work with the historic nature of the Incline District of Price Hill and embraced that heritage, which I believe gives us a competitive advantage over other cities and other communities across the country. I guess I'm out of time. Absolutely. In fact, I helped to lead the effort to have the Incline District of East Price Hill named as such. And I believe, you know, what's great about Cincinnati is that you can't replicate this 19th century technology in these great walkable neighborhoods. You know, you can't manufacture those in ex-urban, suburban part of the country. And so the adaptive reuse of these great old buildings is vital to and part of the reason we've seen this incredible renaissance. I can also say, as a former developer and real estate attorney, that the historic tax credit program makes a lot of these projects doable that would not otherwise be economically feasible. And it requires, in many cases, a local designation. Now, sometimes you can get the designation automatically under federal law, but if you don't have that benefit, given the year of your building, you can essentially get that qualification through a local designation. So they were really helpful to economic growth of old historic buildings. Well, I think that a couple major issues. One, I think the reactivation of public spaces is huge. Not just the beautification of Washington Park, but the activation of Washington Park, from yoga to kickball to concerts to happy hours to, you know, Taste of OTR for Tender Mercies a couple weeks ago. These things that bring positive memories and associations and experiences. Same with Ziegler Park, same with the Riverfront Park. And I believe that the activation of and the preservation and beautification of green and public spaces is vital to the fabric and character community. So I think that's a huge lesson. I also believe that nonprofit development corporations play a major role. And if you, obviously 3CDC is engaged in an enormous amount of investment and historic preservation, and other neighborhoods are not going to be as well funded as 3CDC, but there's some great work happening with Price Hill Well, with the Water Hills Redevelopment Foundation, with the Madisonville Kirk, with the College Hill Kirk. These neighborhoods are all seeing an optimism. As I've been joking lately, and I mean it though, as an Irishman, that beer is going to save the fabric of our neighborhoods. You got the Woodburn on Woodburn, you got Listerman in Evanston, you got Streetside in Columbia Town, in Columbia, Tusculum, you got Westside Brewery in Westwood, and Brink in College Hill, and I'm probably leaving out a bunch, but my point is, Madtree and Oakley, of course, that beer and those coming together and having positive associations with the main elements of business districts as Jim Tarbell used to teach us when we were on council together, and had such great lessons for us, is all the center of activity is the neighborhood business district. And I think that the success that we've seen here can and should be replicated in other neighborhoods. Thank you. It's great to be here. As I've said before, when we helped convince Southwest to go to CBG, they closed down in Dayton. When we worked to get GE to the Riverfront, they said no to a city in Texas. When we helped to get Mercy Bond Hill, they said no to Norwood. And when we helped Children's make the largest single investment in the history of the city in Avondale, they said no to Butler County. These policies and practices are working, and everything we hope to do depends on job growth, which brings more tax revenues and more opportunities to build on the density that, that cities thrive on. We want more people, we want more jobs. And our record of progress is working, and I don't think we should put it at risk. At the same time, we should make sure it's always progressive. From starting the Innocence Project to help innocent people get out of prison, to helping negotiate the city's historic police community relations agreement, I've devoted most of my public life, adult life, to public service and to social justice. And that's why we work to make immigrants more welcome. That's why we're working so hard in collaboration with others to reduce poverty and help 5,000 families transition out of poverty over the next 5 years. That's why we work so hard to take economic inclusion efforts to improve contracts for African Americans from 2% to 17% in just 3 years, after 20 years where it was stuck at roughly 2%. That's why we're announcing, as we've already previewed, but formally announcing and presenting to council policies next week, that will be the largest municipal investment in solar renewable energy that we know of in the country, certainly the largest in the Midwest by a huge margin. That will help us get our energy consumption off of CO2 energy. Thank you all.